2016, regular meeting of the Cape Elizabeth Town Council. Could I have the roll call, please?
Council Chair McCausland.
Here.
Council Garvin.
Here.
Council Grennan.
Here.
Council Jordan.
Here.
Council Lennon.
Here.
Council Ray.
Here.
And Council Sullivan.
Here.
Thank you. Will you join me for the Pledge of Allegiance to the flag?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Town Council reports and correspondence. I just have one thing to mention myself. I wanted to remind our citizens, there is a meeting on Wednesday, October 19th at 7:00 p.m. here in council chambers. It's with our consultants to get some input from the community on our search for a new town manager. Thank you. Anyone else? Yes, Jamie.
Thank you, Chair McCausland. I wanted to report out on the event that we held last month, the Citizen Communication and Outreach Initiative. We had an event over at the Pond Cove Middle School Cafeteria that the public was invited to, similar to the event that we had last year around the same time, just seeking folks' input and opinions on some of the priorities in town as that relates to council goal planning for 2017. Just briefly, the meeting was more lightly attended than last year's event. And really, the point of bringing that up is just to say for the council and for the public watching that one of the things that we're going to be looking to do, I think, at a future workshop is just discuss ongoing ways to facilitate, you know, better input and communication with the public, whether that be more events like this. We've had great success with some of the individually topically focused forums and meetings that we've had throughout August and into September. And so we may choose to continue to pursue that avenue, but we will be looking at that and making a recommendation to bring that up at a future workshop discussion, so.
Thank you. Yes.
I was just going to remind everyone that we have an ordinance committee meeting tomorrow at 1:15 here in the Jordan Conference Room. Oh, no, sorry. I always want to say that, but it's downstairs. We prefer the downstairs room. It's more comfortable.
Thank you. Anyone else? Patty?
On behalf of the Appointments Committee, which is Council Ray, Council Garvin, and I, I'd like to announce the start of the annual appointments committee process. In the next two couriers, you'll see a notice of this process itself. And we are looking to fill vacancies on a number of town committees, and we need volunteers to step up. So applications can apply online. You go online to capeelizabeth.com. The deadline to submit applications is Friday, November 4th. And we have openings on a number of different committees, specifically committees and boards, specifically on the Conservation Committee, Fort Williams Park Committee, the Planning Board, the Recycling Committee, and the Thomas Memorial Library Committee. We will also be looking to staff a comprehensive planning committee. So again, go to capeelizabeth.com, apply online, and we encourage you all to come forward and step up and volunteer. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else? No? All set? We'll move on. Finance Committee report. Michael, are you giving us that update, or Kathy, do you have an update for us tonight?
I don't. I think Michael maybe does.
Yeah, thank you. Because of the earliness of the meeting, we didn't get out and post all of the records for the first quarter, but the town finances can be in good shape. I particularly want to commend the tax office on taxes we're due the other day, and want to commend the citizens as well. It took in almost $3 million in one day. About 800 people paid their taxes all in one day. It all came in, left on Monday. It left for, you know, a tremendous effort to get it all in. And it's probably the highest level of everyone paying their taxes on time during the first due date of any time in the town's history. And everyone sacrificed a lot to pay those taxes, and the staff worked until 7 o'clock that night not me, the ones who do it, to make sure that they all get entered. And want to thank them at the same time at the beginning absentees and handling. A lot of people starting to send in. Maybe you're going to talk about that, Deb? Absentees, yeah. So I'll defer to her on that. But it's a busy time. Appreciate all their efforts. But money's coming in, and the expenditures are in line.
Thank you.
And one other thing, the audit is done. If anyone is really, really interested, if they go online under reports on our town website, they can see our annual financial report. The town council is going to be meeting with our auditors and set a discussion with the town council chair at the next council meeting on November 14th at a half hour before the usual time. The council will be in a workshop at 6:30 to meet with the auditors to have their annual review of the financial statements. And everyone's welcome to come and listen.
Questions for the manager? Anyone? No? Thank you. Deb, did you want to give us an update?
Yes, that'd be great. Thank you very much. As the manager indicated, requests for absentee ballots are now available. We'll be starting voting absentee in this chamber next Tuesday. Monday's a holiday. Regular office hours. We've had over 600 requests already for absentee ballots. We can mail you a ballot. You can call us. Or you can go online on our homepage. In the upper right-hand corner, there's a big check mark, and that is the link to the online request. And as I said, we'll start sending the ballots out next week and starting the process here in the chamber. The deadline to vote absentee is Thursday, November 3rd, so the Thursday prior to the election. And again, I think everyone's off schedule a little bit because the election's a week later this year, November 8th. It's usually the first week in November, but the way the calendar ran, so. Everybody's getting anxious to get those votes in, so we're getting there. So thank you.
Thank you. Thanks for your hard work on that, too. Next up, citizen opportunity for discussion of items not on the agenda. Is there anyone here who would like to speak to an item not on the agenda? Come right up to the podium, give us your name, your address, and try to limit your remarks to about 3 minutes or less. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Chris Straw. I'm at 597 Shore Road. Thank you all for all the time that you put in being on the town council and doing all the work that you do for the town. I'm a member of the Fort Williams Park Commission, and the reason I'm here this evening is I just wanted to address the vote that we took with respect to how we were going to proceed or what we were going to recommend for how we should proceed with the bleachers or the amphitheater project.
We do have that on the agenda tonight.
So I see on the, all I saw was a item for the manager's report. Would that be the time to discuss it?
We have the manager's comments during his monthly report, and then item number 121, Fort Williams Park Amphitheater Proposal.
Great, I'll cover it then, unless you want me to cover it now.
I'd be happy to have you come back if you're going to stay for the rest of the meeting. Thank you. Anyone else have anything to comment on that's not on the agenda tonight? No? We will move on. Town manager's monthly report, including the Fort Williams Park comments. Michael?
Yes, thank you, Chair McCausland. What Chris Straw was just alluding to is I distributed to the council earlier some comments on Fort Williams, noting a couple of things. One, that 40 years ago this month, that was October 25th, the town council adopted the major policy that still stands today that provides that Fort Williams would be predominantly park. It was a very historic vote and probably one of the most historic votes the town council's ever taken. It is what set in motion, you know, a lot of the demolition of the buildings, the layout of the roads there now, and you know, before that there was a lot of sense that the park was going to be something else. And, could have been a campus for the University of Southern Maine. There was talk about putting Unum's headquarters there. There was a proposal, TRICOM, the Research Institute of the Gulf of Maine, was going to have a coastal science park. There was talk about putting affordable housing, a military reserve unit, and it went on and on and on. And that night, the council voted to have predominantly park. So it just struck me it's a good time for retrospection as well as introspection, spilling all of my words today, about, you know, where the park is, and we're going to be talking, or the council's going to be talking about the amphitheater proposal a little bit later, but one thing that came out in that discussion was a lot of concern about the use of the park. So anyway, I wrote a memo to the council about the 40th anniversary, suggested two things. One is that there'd be a public forum at some point on what people's thoughts are where the park is today and what it ought to be in the future. And, you know, these, a lot of talk about overcrowding. Is that a concern with citizens? If so, what do you think you ought to do about it? And actually a forum where there's no specific proposal that anyone is offering from town government or from a committee, that instead it's be, that it be, you know, real, you know, from the grassroots in terms of what folks' thoughts are. The second recommendation was, we had more to do with it, with day-to-day management of the park. And right now we have a Fort Wayne's Park Committee, we have a Fort Wayne's Charitable Foundation, we have a museum at Fallen Headlight Board, and there's various other groups that are interested in the park. There's the dog owners group, there's the neighbors group, there's, I could go on and on and on. And everyone feels so strongly about that park that it, you know, it just takes a tremendous amount of time, particularly on the part of the Director of Public Works, to do the day-to-day management of it. You know, last week, for example, you know, he spent an hour or two dealing with photography firms that wanted to do filming in the park. He spent 3 hours in the last month on an issue involving the types of birdhouses that there were and whether or not they attracted invasive birds or the other types of birds. You know, and you know, I could go on and on about all the different issues. So what I suggested is that my successor give some thought to whether or not there needs to be a park manager, and if so, how that fit into the overall framework of where it belongs on the in the staff or in a department or whatever. So I wanted to mention that.
Thank
you. That was the Fort Wayne's one. Beyond that, I did want to congratulate Paul Fenton from the police department. He is Cape Elizabeth's third graduate from the FBI Academy, which is, you know, quite respected and quite a commitment for the amount of time he was down in Quantico to go through all that program and to graduate from it and to apparently to do quite well. Want to congratulate Community Services on their successful kids triathlon, the first one they've had that was last weekend. About 120 young people participated in that. By all accounts, it was a very successful day. Want to mention the pool is now opened after an extensive renovation, and you know, there's been a few, there was a fuse that blew Monday that kept us closed for a few hours, but you know, generally people are thrilled, seem very happy with the new pool. The, you know, one of the initiatives of the council was, let's do something about the chlorine. And as a result, there were changes made in the pool. And if anyone's been in it the last couple of weeks, or even in the building or in the water itself, it just isn't that big chlorine hit that you get anymore, because there's a different way through the air handling system and through the water treatment system of treating the water. So it's a much more pleasant experience. The locker rooms have been significantly upgraded and cleaned up, and want to thank the pool staff for all of their efforts, community service staff, Greg Miles, who oversaw the project. Particularly want to thank the council and the citizens. The council appropriated, I think, about $700,000 to do that project. And you know, times are tough, and not everyone likes to see money spent. But you know, the community has a big investment in that pool, and it was really good to see. Finally, I want to mention the passing of Joe Sapp, who was a longtime employee at the Department of Public Works. And a lot of people never knew Joe by name, but he was extremely well known in Cape Cottage Woods and the Lawson Road area where you are, Patty. And he was a guy that for many, many years drove the big loader in the snowstorms. And if you think of all those narrow roads through that Oakhurst area, it's never an easy job. Joe was one that, you know, a lot of kids, they never knew who he was, but they always knew he was the old guy in the big truck. And it was a loader, and just a great, great person. He passed away in the last week, and everyone that knew Joe really will miss him and appreciates the really wonderful service that he gave to our citizens for many years. Thank you.
Thank you for the update. Any questions for the manager? No? Okay. Next up, the review of the draft minutes of September 12, 2016. Do I have a motion to accept those minutes?
So moved.
Thank you. Do I have a second? Thank you, Sarah. Discussion? Any comments on those? No? All in favor of accepting? Any opposed? No? Passes unanimously. Thank you. Next up, we have a public hearing on the technical amendments to the Code of Ordinances. I'm going to open the public hearing on this, and I will ask if folks have anything that they would like to come and speak to the council about on this item. You come up to the podium, you give us your name, your address. Again, limit your remarks to 3 minutes if possible. And Jessica, could I ask you, as always, to be our timekeeper? Thank you. And with that, open the public hearing. Yes, come right up. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Penelope Jordan, and I'm one of the owners of Jordan's Farm on Wells Road. My residence is Wells Road in Cape Elizabeth. I am here to speak on behalf of not just other farms in Cape Elizabeth, but also Cape Farm Alliance. And I want to address specifically the technical amendment relative to accessory buildings and structures. As many people know, the Cape Farm Alliance and the farms in town worked for over 2 years to pull together ordinances that would meet the needs of the farms as well as help Cape Elizabeth achieve its goals regarding preserving the town's rural character and protecting farmland. As you know, those two things go hand in hand. The farms in town are a great part, a significant part of the open space and the creation of that rural character. And yes, this was before Airbnb existed. The ordinance regarding accessory buildings or structures was crafted in a way that considered the use of land and would allow the farms to enter into farm-related activities, which is needed in order for a farm to innovate and to remain viable. Farms need to be able to diversify, and they need to also address seasonal housing. The suggested technical amendment in this packet could impact seasonal housing as it's worded today. An accessory building or structure, this is the suggested change, an accessory building or structure that has plumbing shall not be used for overnight accommodations. Our seasonal workers enjoy their overnight accommodations, and they spend anywhere from 4 to 5 months with us throughout the growing season. If this were tweaked to relate to residential only, it would not then present an impact to our seasonal housing on our farms. Therefore, the Cape Farm Alliance and the farms in Cape Elizabeth request that you remove this from the packet going for technical changes for the planning board, move it back to the ordinance committee for further discussion and review, and for modification or removal. The Cape Farm Alliance is eager, as always, to work with any committees in town that work on ordinances as they relate to agriculture in our town.
Thank you.
My name's Jay Cox. I have the Christmas Tree Farm on Sawyer Road. I'm also a member of Cape Farm Alliance. I'm here to speak about the same modification of the definition of accessory building in the technical amendments that are before the council. I think I've pretty much covered all our real problems with the amendments in written comments to the council members. Hopefully everybody got it. But I just wanted to reiterate, along with what Penny said, you know, it wasn't long ago that we spent many months, the farmers, the town staff, board volunteers, going through the ordinances, specifically determining ways they could be modified to support agriculture in town, both current agriculture and also opening pathways to innovation, which we did. Our recommendations were, as far as I can recall, unanimously adopted, and we got great support from the boards, the town, and we continue to, and we're appreciative of that. I guess one of the things I wanted to say is this is a little bit different. We're not really asking for anything here. We're not asking for something from the planning board, and I don't think our membership is interested in a protracted process with the planning board over what seems like a pretty minor thing. We're simply asking that something not be taken away from the work we did not long ago, specifically either modify the language of that of the new prohibition or take that particular point out of the batch of technical amendments before you proceed. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening. Bill Bamford, my wife Lois and I own Maxwell's Farm. My wife is a sixth generation Maxwell farming in Cape Elizabeth. We've
can
been around
for a few
years.
Can you give us your address? Maybe Deb Lane knows that already. But
excuse me?
Can you give us your address?
We live at 112 Spurwink Avenue in Cape Elizabeth. For the last 10 to 15 years, while we've been operating the farm, none of our children have been particularly interested in the farm. And that changed this last year, so we're excited about the future of the farm from that perspective. Growing small fruits and vegetables is extremely labor-intensive. It takes a lot of handwork, and it's absolutely necessary for us, as Penny has said, to hire laborers for the season from away. And we've been doing that for the last 55 to 60 years. So the labor issue is very important for us. It's very important that we be able to have a building that our summer crew can live in for a period of 5 to 6 months that is part of the farming operation and that is not, that's something that's very important to us. And so again, and I'm going to reiterate what Jay said, we're not necessarily asking for anything tonight other than that relating to the farms that this issue just be left as it is. Thank you.
Perfect timing. Thank you. Anyone else? No? Seeing that there's no one else who'd like to speak, I will close the public hearing. And we will move on to item number 119 on the technical amendments. Caitlin, would you introduce that item for us?
Oh, I was just going to say that my parents also own a farm, but we don't have the same issue with housing because we don't have that, but I am also a member of the Cape Farm Alliance.
Thank you. Now, would you like to, I should ask if anyone on the council has any concerns about that? No?
No.
Okay, now would you like to introduce that item?
Sure, the technical amendments is, like I said, last month is a wide range of various topics found within the ordinances ranging from subdivision to definitions of accessory buildings to the new development of the stormwater. We worked over several meetings to go over and review all of the changes that were put before us. The planning board reviewed them. I guess so. At this time, based on what I'm hearing from the public, I would move that we approve the technical amendments but remove the definition of accessory buildings to be, I guess, reviewed by the ordinance committee again, as it seems to have more impact than we originally anticipated.
Is there a second for that motion? Sarah, thank you. Do we have discussion on that motion? Yeah.
I'm sorry.
No, go ahead.
Okay. Yeah. I have a couple of questions. And I've seen that one of the things that occurs to me is that the first thing that struck me was when we had short-term rentals. And there was some concern by a couple people about short-term rentals. And it seemed like a small issue. But as we started to get into it, it was a much larger issue. And I read through this and I'm not sure that maybe there's some different pieces of this, and I think there is. I think you've got the accessory building as one piece, but I do support it going back to the planning board because I think we don't know what else possibly is out there and that other people might either be interested in some of these smaller buildings and renting or whatever, Airbnbs. So I'm not sure it's an issue for the ordinance committee, as I think maybe it needs to go to the planning board and then back to the ordinance committee. Because I thought about short-term rentals, and when we first came up with that, it looked like a small issue, but it became a big issue really quick. And I don't want to miss something by making a decision that maybe is on behalf of a couple people. and then have a couple more people say, yes, but we do this, and then somebody else, we do that. And so, you know, I find that the planning board oftentimes can sort of roll through that stuff and think it through and, you know, maybe consider all the options. And they're good thinkers, I guess. I've seen that they're very good thinkers. I've been to planning board meetings. So that's why I sort of support that, going back to the planning board and then coming back to ordinance after that. So, and I'm not trying to interfere with people who may have some issues and some timing issues, you know, some, so I'm not sure how we work through that, but.
So would you like to make an amendment to the motion, or are you only making a comment?
No, I think I'd like to make an amendment. I would like to see the motion made as presented here, that the technical amendments be approved and the council refer to the planning board for review. The email in question from Mr. Cox about his Christmas tree place, and you know, see how it goes from there. So I guess if that's an amendment, that's what I would like to see it approved as written.
Okay. Is there a second for that amendment, Patty?
I'll second that.
Thank you. Can discussion? Yes.
I'm not sure. That's pretty much changes my original motion completely, so, because I asked to have the accessory buildings removed from technical amendments and approve everything else. So now Kathy's saying put accessory buildings back in and send it to planning board, but have planning board review substantially a lot more things than just accessory buildings definition. So I guess it's almost, in my opinion, two very different motions. Not so much an amendment to my motion.
Okay. Are there other comments on that? Yes.
Well, I'd like to review Councilor Jordan's original motion because I'm not clear what she said. That's the first comment. All right.
Are you asking for?
So.
Point of information.
Point of information, yes.
Are you asking if Kaylin would review that, or would you like Deborah to read it back to us?
Well, if Deborah Lane can read it back to us, and Kaylin can tell us if it reflects what her intention was.
Okay.
It is to approve the technical amendments, removing the definition of accessory buildings with review from the ordinance committee.
So remove accessory building and?
Review by the ordinance committee, okay. Send it back to the ordinance committee.
Okay, all right. So I have comments on that, but I don't know, Chair Coslin, how you want to proceed at this point, given that there are two motions out there.
So I have an original motion and a second, and I have a proposed amendment and a second. I'm going to ask the manager if I've got this right. Do I then need to ask the person who amended the motion and the person who seconded it if they will withdraw that, or do we continue with discussion on the amendment because that's what's on the floor?
You know, ultimately the chair needs to make a ruling on this issue, so it'll be your judgment. Generally, when there's a principal motion offered, it's amendable under the council rules. People can offer amendments, with the one exception is if it totally reverses the intent. You know, like if someone moves to adopt something and then someone, I amended not to adopt it, that's out of order. Generally, a motion that amends and changes aspects of an ordinance, of a proposal, are amendable. And, you know, in this case, you have the principal motion is to adopt the ordinance, the technical amendments as proposed. The secondary caveats to that are, but take out this one line and refer to the ordinance committee. You know, the chair needs to rule that if you think it's one big package and this reverses it, so then you would rule the amendments out of order, proposed amendment out of order, or you feel that these are simply provisions that are subsidiary to the principal motion and that they're in order. And it's your judgment. And then the council could challenge the ruling of the chair if they so chose. It's your judgment to make the determination as to chair of the body as to whether or not you feel the amendment is, totally undoes the original, or it's just changes subsidiary portions of it.
So I will ask Deborah, could you read both of them to us one more time? So the original motion.
The original motion, yep, is to approve the technical amendments, mm-hmm, removing the definition of accessory buildings, sending it back to ordinance committee for review.
And the proposed amendment?
If I understand, the proposed amendment is to approve the technical amendments as written with planning board review of the accessory buildings.
Correct. Yes.
It strikes me that these are similar enough that we could persist with our conversation about both of them. Because we're really saying, do we want to send it back to ordinance or do we send it? They're similar, except where do they go next? So why don't we keep talking and then we'll ultimately have to vote first on the amendment. And then if that goes down, back to the original. Do you see what I'm saying? So maybe, I think it's okay to keep talking because to me they seem somewhat similar. But maybe others disagree.
You know, the chair has an amendment on the floor. It needs to decide if the amendment is on the table.
Well, I am happy to remove that amendment from the table and the second from the table so that we address the original concern, because I know there are certain questions to the motion that was made. I'm happy to address those, remove the amendment from the floor. We can then have further discussion, and if we desire at some point to come back either to another amendment or we vote on the motion on the floor and we either vote it up or we vote it down. If we vote it down, then we have the option for another motion. Reasonable?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Great.
Great.
All right, so now we are back to the original motion and the second. And Kathy, you've commented, and I know Jessica, you had something you wanted to question on the original motion.
Okay. Yes, I am very interested in helping the Farmers and Farm Alliance review this. I have concerns about the process up till this point. I serve in the ordinance committee with Councilors Jordan and Lennon. We worked through the technical amendments. We approved what you have before us, before you unanimously. The issue that has come before us was never discussed in our ordinance committee deliberations. That it came afterwards. So it's an important issue. But I think it's very important that we follow the process and our standards of practice and how we approach these. I think it would be very unwise to kind of do a one-off and just change a word and move on. I think it's, and I remember vividly our short-term rental issues. And I was involved then on the council. You don't always know what unintended consequences may be. And I think that I'm thinking of things as site review or all kinds of things that might need to be looked at. There may be things that we could, other things that we could help with that we're not aware of at this time. And so I think that I would like to see this passed as it's presented to us. I think it should go to the planning board first before it comes to ordinance. There are changes, I know what people have said, but changing, adding a building that could be a dwelling unit, you know, I think that is very appropriate for the planning board to review before anything else happens.
Thank you. Other comments? Yes, Sarah.
I'm not adverse to sending it to the planning board because it has to come back through ordinance after anyway. I mean, it does lead to a more protracted process, which I'm never a huge fan of, but it's okay. But I wonder if we can send it to the planning board with some specific direction and a charge, rather than saying, I mean, to me, this language strikes me as so broad that I think what the Farm Alliance is trying to avoid is completely going back to scratch and
going through this process that they feel they've just gone through, and everyone was happy with it. Not only the time, but they have to show up at all the meetings, and so I don't want to send it back to the planning board saying, you know, should also entail the town's ordinance as reflective of inclusive current. This to me seems so broad that if I were on the planning board, I would think that it would want me to review everything in all these ordinances and anything else that had to do with farming. I think that if I were on the Farm Alliance, I would say, please don't do this. Don't make us repeat this again. So why don't we send it to the planning board with more specific language or just a specific charge? Like, can you just look at these auxiliary dwellings and examine that small thing and see if there's a way that we can accommodate what the farmers clearly already need and also accommodate the code enforcement officers need to have some language and ordinances in place in order to rein in what appears to be a growing Airbnb activity in town. Is that doable? Can we send it to the planning board with a charge?
Yes.
Yeah, the town council passed a policy about a year ago involving referrals to the planning board. And you did lay out certain expectations in the number of months that simple issues had to be looked at and reported back, and that is the deadline unless you say otherwise, unless you say it's a more complicated issue. So, you know, you could ask specifically to look at this narrow issue and not look at the broader issue. That's perfectly within the rights of the council to do so. I also want to say, if I might, yes. Madam Chair, I spoke to the code enforcement officer about this yesterday, I think it was, just to try to get some background. And, you know, the emphasis is this is a technical amendment. It's his feeling that the prohibition's already there. And what it grows out of, and he's actually has had a couple of enforcement actions of what we, short-term rentals are often referred to as Airbnb now, which is one of the common businesses in it. And what we've been having is people taking their garages and renting them out for short-term rentals. So, you know, a lot of people now, you know, you have these issues of these websites that everyone's trying to get a few bucks in their pocket, and they're renting out their homes, and I know Patty's neighborhood had it significant. And now it's gone to the next step, is that people are looking to rent out accessory buildings in order to for someone to have a certain experience, you know, to live in a garage on Two Lights Road, you know, or whatever. And the neighbors aren't liking this. There's people very upset at seeing this trend happen and losing the integrity of the neighborhoods, all the additional cars, all the additional parking. Similarly with farms, you know, farms have a lot of accessory buildings. As the Farm Alliance representative said, farms are changing tremendously in terms of what really is an agricultural property these days. You know, you go out to Flaherty's in Scarborough, for instance, they've got a big barn that's now a wedding center. I don't know when the Farm Alliance last looked at this, but it was several years ago, is my recollection.
2010.
It was 6 or 7 years ago. The way farms are being used in 2016 is totally different than what was going on in 2010. And so that was the reason it was drafted the way it was, because of a desire to help the farms to make sure that our ordinances are in fact compatible with all the different things the farmers want to do in order to preserve the farm without, you know, the fine line is that you can allow farms to do this, 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 and this, and this, and eventually you don't have a farm anymore. You know, all you've got is all these different accessory uses that, you know, and particularly in Cape Elizabeth, where we have a very generous donation definition of a farm. There's a lot of things for the promotion of agriculture and the agrarian economy that we wanted to have in the definition of farms. So there's a real, you just need to be real careful of doing a narrow exemption when it might not have the intended consequences for the larger purpose of what the community has indicated they want, which is preservation of farms. So I just think it needs to be carefully looked at to make sure that we support the farms, we support the farmers, we support the farm allowance, we allow these innovative uses, and at the same time, we don't end up with everyone renting out their garages for people to move in for the weekend.
And Michael, just
unrelated people for money.
Just so I'm clear, the code enforcement officer has already dealt with some issues on accessory buildings.
He's already dealing with these issues.
So his sense is that there is already a definition of the accessory buildings that's clear to him.
And that's why this is in the technical amendment list and not a regular amendment, because he feels he just wanted the language spelled out a little bit clearer so that as he gets challenged on it, he can say it's indisputable and could not be any clearer to cite the recent court decision. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. Caitlin, you had something else?
I was just going to say that I'd be willing to, I guess, amend my motion to send it to the planning board rather than the ordinance committee, if that seems to be the feeling. But still, with what Sarah said, the idea that they're going to look at accessory buildings, because I don't think we need to open a whole new investigation into what farms are doing and what they aren't doing, what they can do and what they can't do down the road, because we just did that 6 years ago. I'm sorry, 6 years ago is not very long ago when you think about we're doing a comprehensive plan 10 years later. We're hopefully later going to talk about a harbor study that hasn't been done in 30 years. So I guess there was a 2 years spent on doing those amendments that went across the whole ordinance. So I guess I would want to more narrowly tailor what we're sending to the planning board, because as written, this is very broad.
Other comments? No. Jessica?
I support, I appreciate what Councilor Jordan said, but I support what the town manager is saying. I again think that we need to be very careful that we don't engender unintended consequences. One word can change things in ways that we can't necessarily predict. And I think to err on the side of caution is the best thing to do in this situation.
Thank you. Patty?
I guess I would support what the manager said and really what's being said here, that in this, I read a desire to help farms, and I think that the larger, you know, purpose of making sure that we are looking at the email from Jay Cox, which specifically talks about that. So I don't think that they're going to go on a wild run with this. I think they're going to look specifically at that and what is going to be something that language that can put some teeth in it for the innovative uses of farms versus these B&B, you know, Airbnb. So I would support the language as it's written here, and I would like to see it go to planning board.
Thank you. Other comments on the motion that is on the floor right now? No? Are we ready to vote on that motion? All in favor?
What's the motion? No, the motion, so you're saying the amendment that I said to make it go to planning board, or original motion?
We're voting on your original motion. We haven't had an amendment.
Okay.
I'd like to vote on the original motion rather than get tangled up on another amendment.
Mm-hmm.
Would you like us to read back the original motion?
I know what my motion was.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear what you said.
I said I know what my motion was.
Okay. Anyone else need that original motion read back again? No? All in favor of the original motion? One. All opposed? Any opposed? Almost all. All right, that motion fails. Now I'm looking for another motion. Kathy?
I'll make my motion that was considered an amendment, but I move that we approve the technical amendments that have been presented unanimously from the ordinance committee, and the council refer to the planning board for review the issue with the owner of Old Farm Christmas Tree Place. Regarding uses permitted on farm properties.
Is there a second for that motion?
I'll second that.
Thank you, Patty.
Yeah.
Further discussion? Yes, Caitlin?
Caitlin's got the same question.
Yep.
Oh, I'm going to make an amendment that we remove accessory dwellings from the technical amendments at this time until the planning board's had a chance to review it and then pass it at a later date.
There's an amended motion?
I think you already have a motion and a second.
We do. So are you amending the motion?
Right, just to remove the accessory buildings definition and pass that at a later date.
Usually, we handle one amendment at a time, and you'd vote on this amendment, and then you'd go to Caitlin to offer another.
This is a motion.
We have a whole new motion.
Oh, yeah, I'm sorry.
We're back on a main motion.
It's back on a main motion. I'm sorry. Sorry about that.
We have a new motion. We have a second for the new motion. Caitlin, your?
Amending it to remove accessory building definition at this time.
Okay. Is there a second for that? Thank you, Sarah. Discussion on the amendment. Jessica?
Yes, I would not support that amendment because by taking this word out right now, we're making a material change in an existing ordinance without any vetting. I think that's a very unwise thing to do.
Right.
Thank you.
I guess I don't understand we're making a material change to an existing.
Well,
all we're doing is accessory dwelling will still exist as it is. It's just the changes won't be applied until we get the report back from the planning board. So as the definition stands now, it will remain. So there will be no changes occurring. So whatever the farms have been doing before, it's not going to change anything. And which clearly the language that's proposed seems to be going to more drastically impact them immediately or in 30 days, right? So if we wait to hear back from the planning board and then put forth whatever changes they propose, those would be the new language for the ordinance.
Jessica?
I'm not sure I understand that.
So hold on one second, Caitlin. Deb, if I could ask you one more time to retract the proposed amendment.
Caitlin's, just the amendment.
Just this amendment. We have Kathy's motion on the floor.
Yep. The amendment removes the accessory buildings definition.
From the technical amendment, not the ordinance. To get.
So without the change in the technical amendments as proposed, that right. At some point we'll be voting on, that without that, we would still be referencing the original
definition
as it
that's
exists
in the ordinance
already.
Exists. Correct.
Thank you. Do we have a second for your amendment?
I did. Heard Sarah.
Yes, Sarah, thank you. Okay. Comments on that?
So just to be clear, essentially what we're proposing is that we adopt this whole package of technical amendments that we did, which is huge. This accessory building was a tiny little thing.
Right.
We're going to adopt everything else, accept it, vote on it, except we're pulling out that one tiny little paragraph, sending it to the planning board with a charge to please clarify all this and send it back to us so we can update that and add it. Is that what we're doing?
That's my understanding of what is proposed and
that's
offered
what I thought
for an amendment.
That that's what I thought that this motion was saying.
The amended motion.
Well, I thought the motion itself was saying that, but maybe I misread it.
Kathy?
Just so I'm clear, my motion was to accept as written. I'm not clear what the amendment is. I mean, I have the paragraph in front of me, and if I'm understanding, and I might not be, I'm hearing that any accessory building or structure that has plumbing shall not be used for overnight accommodations, that it's being asked to have that removed. Is that, am I understanding that? No?
The new language that's proposed, yes.
That's your amendment.
The current definition of accessory building will remain in our ordinance. The change language will not go into effect
with
the change.
So you're asking for that particular sentence to be removed.
Be taken out until all of this can be worked through by the planning board, which is what you're asking the planning board to do, is to take a look at these uses, which would include accessory buildings. So I'm saying why make the change, then ask the planning board, and then have us come back and possibly have to make a change again. Let's keep original language, hear from the planning board, then move forward.
Yeah, if I could just finish.
Yes.
I'm not going to support that. I think that it is not a small change. It's not teeny weeny, it's big. And I think that we should approve it as written. I think Councillor Sullivan indicated that, in fact, the ordinance committee voted 3-0 to approve it as written. And I think my sense is, I think I agree with her. I don't think it's a small change. I think it's a big change, and I don't think that it's prudent for the council to be making large changes without having it fully vetted.
Sarah?
I think you guys are confused. I think what Caitlin is saying is trying to allow it not to be changed so that we're not adopting the change that everyone agrees needs to be looked at.
I understand.
She's trying to say, pull this out so the change doesn't go into effect. If you vote on the whole package, you are voting to accept the change language that you're worried about.
You, Patty, did you have a question?
Maureen's here. Should we, I mean, I feel like you're clear.
That's a good idea.
I think maybe Maureen could give us some to direct. I think it's clear what the intent of the council is asking for. Perhaps there's a clearer process that you could make sure that we deliver, get what we want here this evening.
Very brilliant.
Okay, so what's the question?
Okay, there's a list of technical amendments in front of us.
Yep.
There has been a motion to accept it. All is written except for to send it to Planning Board, the piece that would be deal with Jay Cox's email.
Yes.
So in what form, as it's written here, mm-hmm. can we do that? Or we have an amendment on the floor to take out that piece.
So, yeah, what you're talking
about. So it's I feel like we're saying one
right.
half dozen the other.
What you're talking about, I believe, is on page 9 of the text of amendments, starting on line 16, there is a new sentence that's being added to the accessory building or structure definition, and you're proposing to either adopt that sentence or to delete it and ask the Planning Board to look at this concept
page
again.
Page 9, line 16.
So we want
so
to
what
it.
Caitlin said, we want to do we want to take it out, and will that accomplish that?
You always can take it out. You got me up here, so I will tell you that the one thing you always have to be careful about is this is 56 pages, and there are often interrelationships between various texts of an ordinance. And so as a council, you want to be very cautious about making text changes at this meeting. That's the only thing I would say.
I would agree with that. I think that's very valuable advice, given that this has come through ordinance and been referred unanimously, correct? 3-0 on the recommendation. Wait one second, Caitlin. Anyone else have questions over here, comments? Yes, go ahead.
But both Maureen and Kathy are making my point for me. Kathy said this is an actual large change and it shouldn't be done without being properly vetted, which is exactly what I'm asking for. This sentence to be properly vetted because we now have new information that it is going to have impacts on property owners in this town that we did not think about when the ordinance committee reviewed this, and clearly perhaps that the planning board did not think about when they reviewed this. So we're asking it to be properly vetted, go back, look at it again, so that we're not making these language changes. We've got new information tonight. You're asking us to make a language change to an ordinance tonight that's going to be lasting. All I'm asking is let's not make the language change. Keep it as it is. Have it vetted a little further by the planning board. Planning board then sends it to the ordinance. And then we come back here again. I'm just asking for more vetting, which is exactly what Kathy said just a few minutes ago, that a big change like this needs to be vetted as best as possible, that we shouldn't be making changes on the fly. This is actually making the change. I want to not make the change until we have a little more information.
Jessica?
I disagree. I think that if we do this, we are making a change on the fly. The ordinance committee went through all this. We voted unanimously on what we have presented to the town council. And as a result of late coming information, you're requesting that we make changes to what we have already vetted. I'm saying that the process is very important. And I think that we need to be cautious about what we're doing. And you know, in the future, if we have meetings and deliberations and there's brand new information that comes after the fact, we would be walking down a dangerous road of, well, let's change this at the last minute on the fly because of something new. We're not saying that the changes won't be made. I'm saying the process is very important, and we need to follow the process to make sure that we don't cause more problems later and that we protect the integrity of what we're doing.
Caitlin. I find it funny. We're kind of talking the same thing, except your version and my version are different. I want to protect the process. And the process is, just because this is all in one package, think about it as if they all came to us as 50 different things. We're going to pass 49 of them, and the 50th thing, the council's saying, you know what? We don't think so. I want to send it back and go through the process again. Because we've done that over and over and over again. You know how many times we sent the firing range ordinance back to the planning board, back to the ordinance, back to the ordinance? I'd love to see the records of how many other things we've sent back and forth, back and forth. This wouldn't be a new concept. I'm just saying, take this one thing, just because it's grouped with a whole bunch of other things, is you're losing sight that it's still just one thing that's got to go through its own process. Sorry.
Thank you. Any other comments? Discussion on the amendment. Can you read us the amendment one more time? I'm sorry.
The amendment is to remove the accessory buildings definition of the technical amendments.
Thank you. Are we ready to vote? Any other discussion? All in favor of the amendment? Opposed? That motion does not pass. So now we have the second original motion back on the table again. And Deborah, one more time, I'm so sorry. Could you read us that motion so we know what we're all voting on?
The motion is to approve the technical amendments as proposed and refer to the planning board review of the email from the owner of the Old Farm Christmas Tree Place.
Thank you. Discussion on that motion. Any other comments? Yes, Mike.
Yeah, I just want to brief. I didn't want to speak before the last amendment was voted on. I think there's two issues. One is that I think it's important when you're amending ordinances at a meeting that it be committed to writing and that it be absolutely clear what the amendment is. On the other hand, you know, it's been said that we can't change things at the last minute. And I was waiting for someone to comment, and it didn't happen, over why do we have public hearings? You know, the council needs to be in a position, and I think you all need to understand going forward, and I wouldn't make this comment if I wasn't leaving, probably, that, you know, you've got to be able to amend things after a public hearing. You need to have that flexibility. You need to do it. But when it's a complicated, and when it's a technical amendment, you got to make sure you do it technically in the right way. And so I just encourage the council in the future, when you want to amend things that you know might be coming up, you know, we've had this letter from Jay Cox since October 22nd, that we try to commit amendments to writing so everyone understands what they are. But at the same time, you know, you got to be able to amend things even at the last meeting after the public hearing, particularly if it's not a major substantive change, and the council needs to do that. So I just wanted to say that. I didn't want it left that the council can't amend things after public hearings. I don't think that's good public process.
Thank you. Any other comments or questions? No? No? Are we ready to vote on the motion on item 119-2016? All in favor of that motion? Opposed? That passes 5-2. Thank you. We will move on to item number 120. No, we voted on the amendment a minute ago, and this time we voted on the second original motion. You're welcome. We'll move on to item number 120-2016, Paper Streets. By way of introduction,
can I make public comment on something we've already voted on the last item?
Not usually.
Okay. I'm sorry, we have moved on to the next item. If you want to hold on to your comment till the end of the meeting, you can do that. Thank you. Paper Streets, item number 120. I would like to say a couple of things before we move into that discussion. The community has had 19, count them, 19 public meetings on this issue. We have received input from the Planning Board, from the Conservation Committee. We've had a number of neighborhood meetings. We've had input from our professional staff and from our consulting attorney. We also had a public hearing on September 12th, followed by a council workshop on September 13th. We have spent a huge amount of time over the last 8 or 9 months on this process. I think your council has taken this very, very seriously. We've had a very transparent process, and since we have had so much opportunity for public input, I would like to say if there are people who would like to speak to this item, I would like to ask if there is anyone who would like to come up first who we have not heard from. Is there anybody new we have not heard from before? And if so, would you like to come up and speak to us now? No. Yes. If you'd like to speak to the council, please come up to the podium, give us your name, your address. Please limit your remarks to 3 minutes, and we will take public comment for 15 minutes as council rules allow. Jessica, once again, would you start your timer? Thank you.
My name is Marshall Goldman, 27 Pilot Point Road, Cape Elizabeth. I missed the last couple meetings, so I appreciate the opportunity to say a few words. First of all, I empathize with you completely. This thing has been hashed to death over and over and over. I was thinking about this, and I honestly feel like I'm in the movie Groundhog Day, if you really want to know the truth. I mean, for 5 years, my family has been impacted by this matter. And I am trying to understand really what the town's interest is versus what is practical versus a lot of other things. So I guess I would say there are about three points I would make. When I moved in, which was about 10 years ago, everybody, I mean, it was, got along, and it was a nice place. I mean, Cape Elizabeth still is a nice place. You know, we knew, I knew there was a paper street. I did ask the town about it. The town basically said, we haven't done anything with it. We don't intend to do anything with it. But, you know, be that as it may, things change. Since I've been there, there hasn't been one person that I know of that has not been allowed to walk along the ocean. I understand I've heard some people were yelled at, you know, there's friction now, there's no question about that. And the point is that nobody, there isn't a guard there that is holding a, checking people's passports to see whether you're a member of our neighborhood or you're a member of Cape Elizabeth or you're a member of the town of Portland or you're from Sweden or Japan or Norway. We have tremendous, tremendous views and we have tremendous access to the ocean. Secondly, I know a number of you have been down in front of my house, which is fine. I have no real objection to that whatsoever. Any of my neighbors, if they want to come by, I don't care. Doesn't matter. But if you notice, paths generally are worn. So if you go on Trundy Point, we don't need the Boy Scouts to create a path. I mean, the paths are actually worn. People actually tromp on them. And you can see paths all over the place. There's no path along the ocean. No, people never walked there before, and honestly, very few of them walk there now.
If you could just finish up, thank you.
I think that enough is enough. It's been 100 years since the neighborhood was organized. The town has not needed the paper street up to now. I think to keep it going for the next 20 is just going to continue the argument that's going on in our neighborhood. And I really believe if the town got out of it, the neighborhood would resolve it together. We'd talk to each other. So I would urge you to put this to an end and vacate it and let us move on. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else who has not spoken to the council before who would like to tonight? No? Okay, we still have, I'm thinking, about 12 more minutes if there are other people who would like to come up and speak. Anyone? Okay, we will move on to item number 120. Michael, do you have anything to say here, including introducing our consulting attorney, Durwood Parkinson?
Just for the council's background, Durwood Parkinson is here. Do you want to, through the chair, did you want to make a couple of comments, Durwood?
I would like it if you would. Thank you.
He's with the law firm of Bergen and Parkinson?
Yes.
Ken Amonkman.
Yes, I'm Durwood Parkinson. I'm special attorney for the town on the Paper Streets matter. I've been working with you folks for several years now. As the chairman noted, this has been a very long and thorough process in my experience compared to other towns. It seems like the issues have now been sorted out and put into different categories. And before you are different votes. One is to accept the Paper Streets. One is to deem them vacated. And the third is to extend. Those are all options that you have under the statute. We've put together draft orders for each of those options that reflect the form that you've used before. You had a thorough process back in 1997 as well when you extended, so we kind of built on that and try not to reinvent the wheel. The devil is in the details, of course, when it comes to which streets are going to be vacated, if any, and which are going to be deemed vacated and or accepted. Obviously, a lot of work has been done in that regard, and certainly you have a flexibility to change your mind at this point. I don't think I need to explain to you the basics of paper streets anymore. We've been through that. Those are roads that are shown on our subdivision, never built on. There's a statute that is in place that gives you these options. It's not a very well-worded statute. I can say, and I've said this before, that this town is ahead of a lot of towns in this discussion. Other towns have not addressed the deadline that's coming up with 2017, whether to extend the paper streets. So that's a good thing. You're ahead of the curve there. And at this point, it's up to you, and I'm happy to answer any questions and be available either now or later for comment or feedback. Thank you.
Thank you. Could I have a motion on this item? Kathy.
Yes, thank you.
Hold that thought, Kathy.
There's a draft order in front of you that says, it's in your packet, acceptance of paper streets. It's on the second page of, and three paragraphs down it says, whereas the town council wishes to formally accept certain to the paper streets, that should be of the paper streets. That doesn't come together and spell check very well, unfortunately.
Thank you. Kathy.
I'm going to try to incorporate, but I may just recognize Durwood. I move to accept the motion listed on tonight's agenda with regard to paper streets, sub-items A through C, with the change that Mr. Parkinson just indicated from a spelling issue. And I'm happy to read the streets that are affected by this motion if there's a second, as there are folks here that I presume are interested in the different streets.
Would you like to wait on that until
Right.
Do we have a second?
Yes.
Is there a second for that?
Kathy, could you just, I didn't hear the last part of what you said. Could you just repeat
that? I'm happy to read the streets that are affected. As there are folks here, I assume, that would like to know the individual streets, if they don't have a copy of the agenda in front of them.
So for the benefit of the public, she will read these streets on each one of these categories, but we need a second on that motion. Jessica?
A second.
Thank you.
Point of clarification?
Yes.
So your motion is for all three, section A, B, and C?
Correct.
To be moved and voted on simultaneously?
Yes.
Thank you.
Was there another question?
Yeah, I'm sorry. I question the wisdom of that. I had assumed we were going to go A, vote, B, vote, C, vote. That's how it was in my mind. I'm not ready to vote on them all three together, myself.
I'm debating in my mind whether we actually read through the list first, but I will continue discussion for a minute before we get into that, depending on whether we end up with an amendment, which I'm guessing is what you'd like to do. Patty?
I was going to make an amendment to break it apart.
Into?
Section A, into its own separate motion, section B, and section C.
Okay.
And deal with each to vacate, accept, and extend separately.
Okay. So we have an amendment on the floor to break that up into sections A, B, and C for separate votes. And we have a second on that.
I second that.
Amendment. Thank you, Jamie. Discussion on the amendment. No?
I think it's critically important that we go through these by individual disposition and action versus in one block. I think
separately
it's absolutely
for
critical.
A, B, and C. Thank you. Any other discussion on the amendment? No? All in favor? Any opposed? No? Okay. All right. Kathy, would you like to read the streets in, do I need a?
I think you do.
Okay.
I'd like to move to accept the motion listed on tonight's agenda with regards to paper streets, item A.
Thank you. Is there a second for that? Jessica?
I second.
Thank you. Discussion on A, or are we ready to have Kathy read the streets first? Kathy, why don't you go ahead and read those streets so we know what we're talking about and the public does as well.
Okay, so these are the paper streets to be accepted. U1-1A, Stone Drive North. U1-1B, Stone Drive South. U1-2, Cliff Avenue South. U1-3, Cliff Avenue West. U1-4, Cliff Avenue East. U3-1, Baker Road Extension. U3-2, Forest Road Extension. U3-3A, Stony Brook Southeast. U3-6, Ocean View Extension. U12-9, Elizabeth Road. U19-1, Gladys Road. U19-2, Hampton Road, Penny Lane, 50 feet west.
Wide, I think.
Wide? Wide, I'm sorry, 50 feet wide, pardon me. U19-3, Sweet Fern Road, 50 feet wide. U20-1, Grover Road. U21-1, Dearborn Road South. U29-1, Harrison Avenue. U29-3, North Street. U32-1, Wedgwood Road, 40 feet wide. U36-3, Pine Ridge Road.
Thank you. Discussion about accepting these streets as read. No?
I just have one question. Actually, Maureen, the question's for you. Just as a point of clarification, and while you're walking up to the podium, we had received a question during public comment and hearing that I don't know that we ever got the answer to on Stone Drive and whether or not there was actually a mistake made in the designation there between North and South. Do you know if that was ever reconciled?
There was no mistake. I did check it.
Okay, thanks.
Do you need more information than that?
No, I just wanted to, I meant to ask you previously and forgot. Thank you.
Any other questions? No? All in favor of accepting the streets as just read by Kathy Ray? Any opposed? Nope, that passes unanimously. Kathy?
I move to accept the motion listed on tonight's agenda with regard to paper streets subsection B.
I'm sorry, Kathy, I didn't hear what you said. You moved to?
I said the exact same thing, only subsection B.
To accept?
Yes. No.
To.
No, right. This is to extend, for the streets to be extended.
Correct. That's what
I apologize.
Thank you. Okay. Do I have a second on that motion? Jessica?
A second.
Thank you. Discussion? Jamie?
I'd like to propose an amendment to this motion to pull U-12-5, U-12-8, and U-15-1 out of this list for separate and individual discussion, while continuing to keep them, though, in the list of extend, but just to have them for individual discussion.
Is there a second for that motion?
I'll second it.
Caitlin?
Need clarification what you mean by continue to have them, like just move them to their own list.
So I'm not suggesting that we move them to a different
category, just move
disposition.
Them to their own list.
I'm just saying that I would like us to discuss those individually, those three.
This one.
Okay.
May I ask a question?
Yes.
And have people have the opportunity to vote individually on them as opposed to as part of the block.
Yep.
So in effect, you're proposing we pull those three out and have a vote on the others and have a conversation about those. I'm wondering, I guess I would need an amendment on the amendment. I was just wondering if we could also add one more. I guess, can I do that, or Thompson Road?
So I think like what we just discussed a little while ago was that we would have a vote on an amendment before we'd have an amendment to an amendment.
Okay, so.
That was the discussion we had.
Skip that. We'll stick with Jamie. Okay.
Okay. So, discussion, further discussion on this amendment as seconded. Yes, Jessica.
I guess I'm not quite clear on what the intention is. We certainly can discuss all the streets in this retention block of section B.
Yes.
I don't understand really why we need to pull some out to discuss
Michael.
Them. We can discuss them all.
Just the intent is similar to dividing it into A, B, and C, as now requested on the B list, is to take a couple of streets and vote on them separately.
So we have.
But keep them in the B category, but to vote on them separately.
Jim. My intent, and for clarification, is to put on record vote on those individual streets, as opposed to as part of the block.
Thank you. Other discussion?
I guess I would just say, I think the council was originally split on those streets, so it makes sense for us to, as Jamie's saying, to put on record what our feelings are around them, and to show unanimous vote in one area, and perhaps unanimous in the end, or not.
Thank you. Other comments on that? No? So the motion that we're voting on at this point is to take those three streets out of the list in category B and make them their own separate list. That's what you're proposing that we vote on. Yes.
List.
Any other comments on that? No? All in favor of taking those out for a discussion? Opposed? So that passes 5-2. So I'm thinking I need a motion now to discuss those three streets specifically within the extension category as it's proposed right now.
Okay. I think the motion was each individual.
Mm-hmm. Was it individually?
Yes, I'm sorry.
Yes?
Okay. Yeah.
So I need a motion then to discuss each street individually.
As a point of order, if it makes more sense to vote on the remaining ones, I don't know if that makes more sense.
So we still have a motion on the
yeah.
table?
Yeah. Mine was an amendment to Kathy's motion on B, but we still have all the rest of them that are in the B block, so.
Yes. My sense is that the rest of them will go by relatively quickly and without a lot of discussion. So I think in the interest of time, and particularly I think in the interest of the public spending their time here, it might be useful if we had the discussion first about those three streets and then okay. tidied up by finishing up with the rest of Category B. So do I have a motion to discuss those three streets?
I think we already did that.
Oh, I'm sorry, one at a time?
Yeah, someone ought to start on one of the three streets.
Jamie.
I move that we extend U12-5 Surfside Avenue as outlined in the recommended language here.
Thank you. Is there a second for that?
I'm sorry, he moved to extend that particular, you're taking one at a time and you moved to extend that?
Yes.
Correct.
Okay, thank you. I'll second it.
Thank you. Discussion on that. All in favor?
I'm happy to start the discussion. I'm sorry to feel like we're finessing or nuancing this, but I think it's important that we have individual discussion on this, and I appreciate, Patty, your comment that during our workshop there was, I think there was not consensus as it related to some of these, and so I think it's important that we discuss them further here. Referring to your comments at the beginning, Molly, I completely concur that we've had an exhaustive amount of public input on this, and I think we've done an incredibly thorough job in how we've handled and approached the disposition of these streets. On a personal level, I've taken an enormous amount of time to talk to many folks that live on the streets that we're referencing here, and I've appreciated all of the input that they've given me and the background and context as it relates to their individual situations. At the end of the day, though, while there are a lot of peripheral issues around this, what we are voting on today is what to do in terms of exercising the town's rights as it relates to these streets. We are not voting on whether or not a greenbelt trail should be somewhere. We are not voting on whether or not certain people have certain deeded rights and certain people don't have deeded rights. What we are voting on today is what we should do in terms of exercising the town's rights relative to these streets. That all being said, I favor extending U12-5 Surfside Avenue. I also, and we'll be bringing this up later on in the evening, will be looking to make a recommendation that further exploration be done relative to any greenbelt trail placement on this and some of the other streets noted. Because the basis for which we're using as extending here as a part of the recommendation that was made by the Conservation Committee and the Planning Board and the Town Planner was for potential use as a trail. So what I think we need to do is take a more exhaustive look at whether or not that rationale and justification exists. The only way to do that is if we extend our rights. If we vacate the rights, they're gone forever. Back in 2012 and 2013, the Conservation Commission put together a very thorough plan that involved a lot of public comment and public input that resulted in the Greenbelt Plan. In January of 2014, that plan was adopted by the Town Council. I'm not prepared to summarily dismiss all of that work based on an opinion that perhaps there should or should not be a greenbelt trail there. I think there's a process that we need to go through, and while it might not be expedient, I think it's the right thing to do. We had another issue that we were just talking about before about honoring process, and that's what I think we need to do in this case.
Thank you. Other comments? Yes.
Can I just clarify, Jamie, what you would like to do or what you plan to do personally is vote to extend, but also suggest or request that with this extension, it goes back to the Conservation Commission for further exploration, explanation, and then comes back to us for another vote? Is that what?
No, the vote is to extend. I will be bringing up separately a motion about referring to the Conservation Committee an action to revisit and review the 2013 Greenbelt Plan as it specifically relates to this and several other potential Greenbelt trails. And when they come back to us with that, we'll have more thorough information to do with however we choose to at that time. But that's my recommendation.
Other comments, questions, Patty?
Okay, so potentially, I think that could be okay. In the fact that I think, Durwood, we asked you at one point.
Durwood, would you come up and speak at the podium, please?
I made you say it over and over again. The fact that you can't go ahead and put without, you know, a thorough thought out plan, the council or this community cannot put in a trail unless a road is accepted.
That's right. You have what they call the incipient rights now, and you can vote to extend those incipient rights for another 20 years. But if you want to actually finalize and take some action on the property, you have to accept them.
So in theory, tonight, for the purposes, if we were to agree to extend, to go through the process that Jamie is suggesting, we would then, you know, in by order of this, have to come back and have another dialogue.
Yes.
Before the September deadline, is it September, of 2017, to make a,
you would be extended. You'd have another 21
years.
But
we would have to, as a council, agree to accept this.
Right.
And thereby accept the plan or the recommendations of the Conservation Committee. While it's, you know, I guess would be, thank you.
Thank you.
While I feel like there is personally, and I know I said this in the workshop, that keeping this uncertainty really, as somebody said, perpetuates the animosity. It's really unfortunate that this, your community of Shrakers has had to be under this tension based on this paper street. I feel like we need to either, you know, accept or vacate. I feel like leaving things in limbo is not a good plan. It's also not a secret that I feel like this has been a conversation of property rights, and it was my view that the paper street, while it would make a beautiful path, it was not an appropriate place in a residential neighborhood. So having said that, I'm not sure how I'm going to vote on this, but I just wanted to put that out there, that this truly was, you know, a discussion of property rights of one trumping another. And to me, it, as I've walked that path, and it's very close to the properties, if it were to be put in, and we can go down a path and look at it. I feel like it's not an appropriate place for a path. It really, it's too residential. There's plenty of open space. I think the people along Surfside Ave have always allowed people to walk there. I've run there for years. I've never had anybody send anything. So that's my view. And I hope that we can get some resolution to this very soon.
Thank you. Sarah.
I agree with you, Jamie, that I think it would be helpful to send it back to the Conservation Commission to again answer the question, do they really think that it would be a good place for a path. My personal opinion is this was the only path that was retained on this entire list that is so intrusive into private property. The other ones that were quickly taken off when the people complained. There were several. This one, for some strange reason, remained on. I've never thought it's an appropriate place for a greenbelt public path. I do think it's appropriate for neighbors to wander there. They always have. They always will be able to. Their deeded rights are not impacted by our vote. Our only job as a council is to look at this in the town's interest. And I cannot think, given that I don't think it's a good place for a public path, nor do I think the neighbors would want the public pouring in and walking through. nor do I think the public would particularly enjoy this extremely brief walk. So my question is, if it's not a really great pace for a path, what other reason do we have to extend it? To me, I agree with Patty, it just perpetuates this incredibly unfortunate high amount of tension and stress and uncertainty that I think is unfair and has gone on long enough. So unless we think that this is a great pace to put a greenbelt path, I think it's incumbent upon us as individuals to vote to vacate it, because there's no other reason to keep it. To me, set a dangerous precedent in terms of intruding on people's fundamental ability to enjoy their property with some security and some peace, and P.S., the neighborhood to have some tranquility. The council has always, always leaned in favor of honoring private property. This is a departure from that. And so I think unless we deem it so crucial to the Greenbelt Trail that it links, somehow creates, completes the whole circle, or somehow adds such an amazing place to it that we feel it's worth it, I don't. I feel that we should vacate. But I welcome the input of the Conservation Commission, and I'm more than happy to bring this up again and have another conversation about it after they look at it and report back to us.
Thank you. Other comments? Jessica?
Yeah, I have actually some prepared comments that I'll go ahead and read, and I included Atlantic Place in my prepared comments. I know we're not voting on that, but I'll go ahead and say Atlantic Place as well, because if I don't, it messes up the tense of everything. But before I start, I will say I don't see this as a private property issue, honestly, because this is a paper street that has been recorded and is public access. So here are my comments. We are finally here after 3 long years and countless hours of time studying our paper streets. And I speak to a particular controversy on 2 of these, and those are Surfside and Atlantic Place. Surfside Avenue and Atlantic Place are paper streets recorded in 1911 as part of the Shore Acres subdivision. On September 8, 1997, it was moved by Councilor Rosemary Reed and seconded by Councilor William Jordan that the council retain the town's rights to its paper streets for the next 20 years. At the public hearing just prior to the council vote, there were no comments. The vote was 7-0 in favor of retaining the town's rights. Since then, and for decades before, the public has enjoyed its legal rights to walk along Surfside Avenue and Atlantic Place, as well as on other paper streets throughout town. Recently, new homes have replaced older ones along the ocean side of Pilot Point Road. These properties were bought with full knowledge of boundary lines and the existence of abutting paper streets that were recorded in 1911. It is important to note that the lots in question are not oceanfront lots, but rather ocean view lots, as was noted in one of today's emails that the council received. Although the owners of these lots have unfettered views and use of the paper streets they border, they do not pay full waterfront property taxes. Some new owners have attempted to prevent people walking on both Surfside and Surfside Avenue and Atlantic Place. I lived in Broad Cove from 1994 to 2000 and used to walk parts of Surfside Avenue regularly and always felt welcomed. However, in 2013, I walked Surfside Avenue and was personally challenged in a negative manner. 2 years ago, attempts by a few property owners to prevent public access to Atlantic Place landed the issue in court. The Maine Superior Court upheld Atlantic Place's paper street status and the town's rights in its March 23, 2016 decision. Our options are to vacate, retain, or accept our town's rights. To vacate the town's rights would mean forever losing public access to this beautiful, unique area. I would prefer to permanently accept Surfside and Atlantic Place, but I will vote to retain the town's rights of access for the next 20 years. By retaining the town's rights, we are not taking anything away from these few people who live on the ocean side of Pilot Point Road. We are only maintaining the status quo and the public's rights held since 1911. The neighborhood problems we've been hearing about and that some of us have experienced are recent and have developed because some people have tried to change the status quo of public access so clearly reaffirmed by the town council in 1997. There is a potential of a greenbelt trail within these paper streets. Our trail standard is a 5-foot wide walking path in natural conditions. Surfside Avenue ranges from a minimum of 23 to a maximum of about 150 feet wide. If a town greenbelt trail were ever to exist, there is ample width for safe passage for a simple natural walking path. As town councilors, our jobs are to protect the assets and the interests of the town as a whole for the good of the community. We should not favor the personal interests of a very few at the expense of our entire town. There is no logical reason to vacate these two paper streets and forever lose the town's rights. However, there are compelling and logical reasons to retain the town's rights and assets. I believe that we should retain our rights to Surfside Avenue and Atlantic Place, that it is our duty as elected officials to protect the rights of our entire community in as an impartial, dispassionate way possible based on the facts and the legal precedents. I also would like to say that I am in support of Councilor Garvin's comments that we might consider as a separate item referring these issues back to the Conservation Commission. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else have comments? Kathy.
I'm not nearly as eloquent as Councilor Sullivan. And no, we did not compare notes, but I'm afraid some of my comments are similar, but I'm going to read them anyway. I'm supporting the decisions to accept, extend, and vacate the paper streets being proposed on our agenda this evening. The town council has done extensive work over the last year, and I'm comfortable that we have come to the correct conclusions. The town council has an obligation to protect the assets of the town. There has been much discussion and information circulating about some of the streets in question. It is disappointing to me that some of the information is not factual. Why people make things up to support their position concerns me. I won't go into all the misinformation I have heard, but I would like to address some items that I think are important. I've heard multiple times from some of the Shoreacres neighbors, that no one has ever been denied access to the paper street along the waterfront. However, I was personally yelled at and told I was on private property when I walked the paper street a couple of years ago. When it was explained to the person that I was a town councilor looking at the paper street, the tone changed. I also feel I need to comment on other items that were brought up by citizens in reference to paper streets. Parking on public roads in Cape Elizabeth is not a public paper street issue. And trespassing is not a paper street issue, but a police issue. In a recent court ruling, two residents of Shoreacres attempted to claim ownership of Atlantic Place. The premise was that the town had vacated its rights to Atlantic Place. The court declared this proposed ownership as void because the property had not been deemed vacated by the town of Cape Elizabeth. Regardless of what decision the town council makes, I'm clear that there will be unhappy citizens. It is not my job to make a vote that is popular or vote for what my friends or family want. It's my job to protect the assets of the town. By the proposed motions here before us, we are only extending the rights the town has had for about 100 years. We are not taking away anything from any citizens. We are merely maintaining the status quo.
Thank you. Anyone else? No? All in favor of the vote to extend the town's rights on U12-5? Opposed? 4-3. Thank you. I need another motion on the vote to extend on U12-8, which would be Atlantic Place.
I move that we extend U12-8 Atlantic Place.
Thank you. Is there a second? Kathy?
Yep.
Thank you. Discussion on this item? No? Everybody said what they had to say? Mm-hmm. Okay. All in favor of extending on U12-8? Opposed? 4-3. Thank you. And I need a motion on, I think it's U15-1. Was that the third?
I move that we extend U15-1.
Do I have a second on that? Thank you, Jessica. Discussion on U15-1. No? All in favor of extending U15-1? Opposed? I'm sorry, Caitlin, were you opposed? Or did you
said extend.
I'm sorry, what? You
extend.
Voted to extend? So was that 6-1? Did you vote to oppose? Thank you. Okay. And now I think we are back to, I've lost track of motions. Are we back to?
The balance of the list.
Right? Yes. Do we have a motion on the balance of the list, or now do I need a motion on the original list? Was that your original motion, and then we had an amendment?
I originally made the motion for all of them, so I don't know.
Jessica, do you want a new motion?
And then we had, I'm sorry, remind me, did we have an amendment on taking those three out?
Yes, we
okay.
did.
Yeah.
All right, so now we're back to your original motion on the rest of Category B.
Okay.
Is that correct? I'm asking to make sure I get the procedure right. We have a motion already on the rest of Category B. Yes. And we have a second on that. Okay. Discussion on anything else on Category B? Yes, Sarah.
I will vote on these as a block to keep things moving and simple, but I would like to go on record of saying I do not, I am not in favor of extending half of Thompson Road. I think that we should vacate the whole thing based on, again, the fairness issue. We're putting 7 properties at risk to having a road essentially go through their backyard, so they'll have a road both in their front yard and their backyard. And I think that Mr. Nickerson in particular has pointed out that the planning board, in order to let him build his house, was required to spend thousands of dollars on landscaping to try to ameliorate the border between the two, and if a road were ever put in there, it would essentially go straight through that. I think that he was guided unfairly. So I don't think that one person retaining, essentially this vote is so that one person can have access to his property and maintain its value, but it's at the expense of 7 other people. So I just want to say that if we were breaking this out, I would vote against extending that portion of Thompson Road, but I know that I would be far outvoted, so I'll vote as a block. I just want that in the minutes that I would like to vacate all of Thompson Road.
Thank you. Kathy?
I agree with some of what Councillor Lennon has said, but I believe that by extending it, we are not indicating we are building a road. We're just extending the street. And that discussion about how that may, you know, break out later on is still undecided. Mm-hmm. So I hear what Councillor Lennon's saying, and I've heard the concerns about that, and I certainly want to explore it further, but I think extending it doesn't indicate that we're building a road. So that's my understanding, and if I'm incorrect, then please correct me.
Any other comments? No? All in favor of extending on the remainder of those streets on the list in Category B? Any opposed? No? That passes unanimously. Kathy?
I move to vacate the following streets as listed on tonight's agenda in subsection C.
Would you like to read those? Because I think that is a fairly short list.
Sure. I'm going for short. The streets are included as U3-3B Stony Brook Southwest, U10-1 Thompson Road, the portion extending west from the point beginning 750 feet from Shore Road, U12-1 Avon Road, any portion extending to the west of the northwest property line of lot U12-12, U15-2 Balsam Road, U30A-1 Allen Road, U33-6 Hill Place, and U36-4 off Pine Ridge Road.
Thank you. Do I have a second on that? Caitlin?
I'll second it, and
thank you. Did you have a question?
I noticed that we extended it to 750 feet for Thompson Road, and then we got that email as well saying they're fairly certain that the other would have been a little bit short. Are we fairly certain that 750 feet is definitely going to gain? I mean, I just want to make sure before we go into that, somebody has done somewhat of a stick measurement.
So the 650 feet was using the GIS and measuring that way. It was fully my intent, if you got to this point, to actually do a little more work on it. Once you got to this point, I pulled the assessing records, talked to the assessor about his confidence, added everything up, and it looks like 750 should be fine. I also, you probably saw in the emails, encouraged the Kruger Quinlans to do anything they could, look at deeds or whatever, surveys, and they did that as well, and they also thought that 750, you have to be careful because Thompson Road intersects Shore Road at an angle, so you want to make sure you're picking the distance that is the longest point, and all of us feel like 750 should do it.
Okay. That's all.
Thank you, Maureen. Any other comments or questions, either for Maureen or anyone else, on the motion on the table? Any other discussion on that? No? All in favor of vacating as outlined in that category C? Any opposed? Nope. Passes unanimously. Thank you. And thank you, Maureen and Sherwood Parkinson. Yes.
If it pleases the chair, I'd like to make a motion from the floor outside of the agenda.
Thank you.
Thank you. I propose that the Town Council direct the Conservation Committee to revisit and review the 2013 Greenbelt Plan previously adopted by the Town Council on January 6, 2014, specifically as it relates to the potential trails indicated along the paper streets of Surfside Avenue, U12-5, and Atlantic Place, U12-8, as well as any potential future trail development along the paper street at Lighthouse Point Road, U15-1, and provide an update to the Town Council within 6 months. It is requested that the review encompass a thorough assessment of the technical and logistical feasibility, along with all other practical considerations, to determine a complete cost-benefit analysis of any potential trail development.
Thank you. Is there a second to that? Yes?
A second.
Thank you.
I was going to second it.
Okay.
So I think what he made one motion, which was to suspend the rules to pick up an item on board.
Oh, thank you.
Sorry.
All right, so do we need to vote on suspending the rules?
You should suspend the rules.
My apologies.
I have a second. Caitlin, thank you. All in favor of suspending the rules? Thank you. That passes unanimously. And
hello, cart. Here's horse.
Thank you. And now I won't ask you to
offer that motion.
Ask you to offer that motion again, as you stated.
I move that we do what I just said.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Second. Thank you.
Second.
Jessica, discussion about that? Yes, Sarah.
Quick question. How did you come up with 6 months? That seems like a long time frame to me.
I had a conversation this morning with the chairman of the Conservation Commission. I also spoke to somebody else on the Conservation Commission yesterday, and I spoke to Maureen earlier today as well. I indicated an interest in having this resolved quickly, a period of months, not years, and mindful of some of the other things that are on their plate currently. It felt like 6 months was a comfortable window. It was even indicated to me that there's potential for it to be quicker than that, but I didn't want to make an unreasonable request of the Conservation Committee. So that was how I came to 6 months.
Any other comments or questions? No? No? That was a beautifully written motion. Thank you.
Welcome.
All in favor? Any opposed? No? That passes unanimously. Great. And now, do I need a motion to go back to our regular order of business, or do we?
You just continue with it.
Okay. Thank you. We will move on. I think we're done on Paper Streets. And if I could just ask people, as you leave, council is still in session, so last time as folks left, it got pretty noisy in here. I had to use my gavel a couple of times. I don't like to have to do that. So if people are headed out, could you hold your comments until you get out of the room? Thank you. Thank you for coming. We will move on to item number 121-2016. Do we have anyone who has come to speak to that item tonight?
Chris Straw.
Mr. Straw.
2 hours later.
Do you represent anyone?
I do not know. I don't think so.
Oh, you want me to introduce the item before he does?
Chris, while folks are filing out and Maureen is moving things around, I'll just ask Michael to introduce the item and then have you speak. How's that? You can stay right there.
Sure. Were you representing the commission, or you were representing your own viewpoint on this? Okay, then I didn't want, if they had asked you to represent them, I didn't want to usurp that time. Yeah, I just wanted to bring the council up to date. The Fort Williams Advisory Commission, a few months ago, when it was in that name, had recommended to the town council some funding for an amphitheater, essentially where the old bleachers are. They held a public forum over the summer, got some public comment, subsequently discussed and debated again. And at their last meeting, they passed an item that's here on your agenda. And what it is, after some general discussion, it was moved and seconded that in light of the feedback received at the public forum, the increased use of the park and opening of the children's garden, the committee, which is now known as the committee, has decided not to develop and submit a proposed amphitheater project for consideration by the town council this time. It was a 6 yes and a one no vote. And you know, so if you go back up above that, the reason it's before the council and before the council now is the committee is advisory. There were monies that were set aside in the budget, so we need to bring some closure to this on the part of the council as well. It just ought not to stand there as simply a committee proposal. Mm-hmm. The second part of it is that we actually, the council would ask the committee to provide a list of updated capital improvements, so that they go on with looking at other things in addition to this amphitheater. It doesn't preclude them from looking at the amphitheater again or a smaller scale aspect of the amphitheater. It sort of just, it acknowledges the vote they have. It encourages them to, well, look at your priorities now that this is your thinking. And that's it.
Thank you. Would you like to step right up again? Just give us your name, your address, and limit your remarks to 3 minutes if you could.
Yes. Hello, Chris Straw, 597 Shore Road. I apologize for not seeing it was an actual item on the agenda tonight. So as you might imagine, I was the one on the vote. And I just wanted to bring a couple points up with the council and also suggest that you reject the vote that we took. Number one is, as you likely know, one of the goals for the town council for the year was that a conceptual plan be created and approved by you for this area. We didn't, my understanding is, of what we voted on is, we didn't reject any plan, we didn't even put forth a plan, we basically just punted on one of your goals, and you had instructed us to take a particular course of action, and we basically said, nah, we're not gonna do that. So you might decide, yes, that was the right way to go, but I thought it was somewhat inappropriate for us as a committee, an advisory committee, to basically reject one of your goals without first getting approval from you. So that was point number one. Point number two, one of the issues that was raised for why the other members voted this way was the feedback we received at the public meeting that we held. If I counted correctly, there were 8 people who spoke against the amphitheater, 8 people. And notably, over the last couple of years while I've been on the Fort Williams Commission, I routinely discuss, I have 3 kids, they're in middle school and elementary school, and when I go to various events, I routinely discuss with the parents, and then they're in all sorts of after school activities. I'll ask them, oh, how do you feel about Fort Williams? How do you feel the direction it's going? Do you have any issues, concerns, there anything you'd like addressed? And invariably, I'll bring up the amphitheater. And it's been met with near unanimous support with almost every single parent I have talked to. And this is dozens of parents. Notably, not a single, I think there was maybe one person under the age of 50 with an elementary school parent that actually showed up at the meeting. So to take the meeting and basically view it as a litmus test for how the town viewed the amphitheater, I don't think was necessarily the appropriate direction for the commission to go, to the extent that's what ended up happening. And you'll note with the language, you can interpret the language as you see fit. The other issue that came up is there was a letter to the Courier raised by one of the former commission members, basically, and it was reflected also in the comments at the meeting, that somehow the amphitheater plan is contrary to the master plan for the Fort Williams, that it's not actually captured in the master plan, and actually nothing could be further from the truth. If you look at the master plan 2011, bullet point 712 says, look to the 2009 project report for recommendations. If you go to the 2009 report, it specifically talks about amphitheater type events. It presents two different options, one option of which is basically the exact design that we proposed for the amphitheater. So there was some misinformation that was being spread saying that this was somehow not in the master plan. It actually was. And the final point that I would raise, and what I think was the real motivating factor behind why we punted, was just the level of traffic in the park that we experienced this summer. The amount of usage at the park this summer was extreme. I think all of us, rightfully so, felt, my God, the park is really seeing a lot of usage. We really need to figure out how to deal with this. And if you'll give me another 30 seconds. So.
Yep.
We're trying to grapple with how to deal with that. That's an issue that is going to be much larger than us, that really is going to turn on what you guys are going to do. But to basically torpedo a project that is specifically targeted at providing a benefit to town residents, not to people away, but town residents, by virtue of a large number of people from away coming to the park, it doesn't correlate. There's a disconnect there. Nevertheless, that was one of the major reasons, I think, behind the vote. So with all that said, obviously, at the end of the day, we're just advisory. It's whatever you want to do, but please keep that in mind in deciding how to proceed. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks for coming. And thanks for staying, too. Okay. Is there a motion on item number 121? And our recommended motion in our packets is to receive the report. Request the committee to provide to the town manager an updated list of capital improvement priorities for the park for consideration by the council. Jessica.
Aye, so move.
Thank you. Is there a second? Patty. Discussion? Yes, Sarah?
Thank you, Chris. That was very helpful. And sorry you had to wait for 2 hours to get your 3 minutes. So, Mike, are we planning to have a workshop on this?
You know,
it just seems like a massive topic with all kinds of factors in it, and my brain's cluttered with possibility and proposals and priorities and what even our role is, especially having just listened to Chris. So I'm confused, like, how we're going forward. I get we're going to get a capital improvement plan. Are we going to have a chance to kind of casually talk about this before we vote or make decisions?
Yeah, it's through the chair. Yes. You know, Chris, I think made a good point. You know, one main reason this had to come back to the council was it is a council goal. It was a council goal to look at an amphitheater plan. So it's up to you to decide in the end the next points that you want to make. You know, if the council wants to have a forum specifically on this issue again, you can do it. I had suggested in my town manager report, you might want a general forum on the overall direction of the park. Similarly, anything that comes forward in the capital improvement plan, you have a chance to look at all those things. You can have a workshop on that. You ultimately have budget processes on that. And depending on the scope of it, you know, you do a whole lot of other things. So the council can essentially do whatever it wants. But, you know, I do encourage you, for the efficacy of the committee's work, is that you allow them to participate in the capital improvement process. I've asked all department heads and the major committees by November 1 to submit a proposed capital improvements to be included for consideration as the next town manager prepares his or her budget. And, you know, and unfortunately, you know, if this doesn't happen, I don't want a situation like we had last year where the Fort Williams, then at Fort Williams Advisory Commission, essentially came in the night of the council meeting and said, here's our list. That was not in the interests of good public process. So I think they're legitimately, do you have a meeting next week, is it, I think? What's that? Yeah, coming right up. In the committee, I know it's on their agenda to look at the capital, but the council can do whatever it wants with this. You know, this was your goal, is your goal.
And Sarah, I think your point is well taken. I think having a broader discussion about, and to Mike's point earlier in our meeting tonight, that he proposed a couple of directions that the council might take in thinking about the future of the fort and how we as a community want to use it. And I'm very appreciative of the work that the folks on the committee have done. And I think it's really appropriate at the council level that we take that up and have a further discussion. Jamie.
Can I just ask a point of clarification around the goal and Chris, what you were referring to? I mean,
It is on that.
No, I know. I was just looking at it. But so I guess my question is, do we not have, our goal is to review and approve a conceptual plan. That doesn't necessarily mean approve the project to move forward.
Right.
So I don't know if those have become inappropriately intertwined, mm-hmm. but a conceptual plan that is not a priority to be executed tomorrow is just that, it's a conceptual plan. Mm-hmm. So I'm kind of confused about the difference between moving forward with an actual project to build the amphitheater versus when we did our goal planning at the beginning of the year, I looked at this as much more preliminary, I guess. So maybe I was confused about the goal at the time, but I had assumed that we were just going to be looking at a plan, not necessarily approving a project, that there would be much more, you know, further points of decision and sort of toll gating on that before moving ahead. So.
Caitlin?
I was looking at the goal as well, and it's, you know, it's a plan for the bleacher area. It's not so much a plan that says we have to have an amphitheater.
That's
I mean, another point too. I think as the Fort Williams Committee, you know, as advisory, we're asking them for advice as what we should be doing with this area, and that's what I had hoped to get back from them, not a, we don't want to deal with this,
mm-hmm.
which is kind of what I'm feeling like they're sending back to us. And so I'd like, you know, it's, we can either accept it as is, I guess, and I'd like to see something go on to a workshop that we need to have a much more in-depth, broader conversation about the Fort Williams Park as a whole and where we want to see and if we want to push this further, or we send it back and say we want some kind of a plan, a thought, an idea of what you plan to do with it. Do you just plan to leave it as a grassy hill? You know, or, and obviously we need the priority list, because it's coming that time of year.
Right. Jessica?
Well, actually, Patty had something, raised her hand before I did.
I guess I was going to, I'm on your page, Caitlin. I feel like this is a, with what Mike has brought up with the issues of management and traffic, I feel like those are currently trumping the dream of this bigger plan. I think all we're doing, and to me, it sounds like we're just kind of parking that bigger plan for now until we look at those broader issues, and then we can pull that back out. I don't feel like we are voting this down, you know, forever by accepting recommendation and then looking at those issues. So I feel like this is still, you know, in the queue for at some point. It's just kind of on the back burner is what I'm feeling.
Okay, thank you. Jessica?
I agree. This is, to me, it's, you know, it's certainly in stall mode, but it could come back. I think that if we proceed with the concept of having a forum on the general direction of the park as a whole, I think that's a really good idea. at the meetings I've attended of Fort Williams, now the Fort Williams Park Committee, you know, there were citizens coming, beginning to come on a regular basis, that are very concerned about the growing traffic and the noise and the this and the that. And so I think that stepping back and taking a global look at the park as a whole, I mean, as you know, I gave the council with town manager's help the paper about revenues in general. I mean, I think that we're headed for a larger discussion of the park. But, you know, to say that an amphitheater could come back someday, well, yeah, it could. You know, we don't know what ultimately we're going to do with that area, with the bleachers and all that. The parts that were dangerous have been removed. And but, yeah, it could come back someday. I just think that now is the time, given all that we've been hearing, to just step back and take a look and then proceed after we have public comment, maybe go to another workshop, but at some point.
I guess I agree with all that. The point I just wanted to make was, if the concern is that we've not satisfied a goal, I don't know that by the definition of what the goal was that that's actually accurate. So, you know, the conceptual plan could be to do nothing right now.
Right.
It doesn't have to, there's nothing in the goal that says anything about an amphitheater.
Correct.
So it says a conceptual plan for the bleacher area. So,
yes, and we have in the past restated goals.
Yeah.
In the middle of a year, or in the end of a year, as a result of new information, what have you. I don't see that this is, you know, necessarily a negative thing at all.
Right. And to your point, I think we have, am I correct, one more council meeting in this council year, and then we have a new council in December, so we'd be looking at new goals. Anyone else? Yes, Sarah.
Very quick comment. I feel like, you know, we're almost a victim of our own success. I mean, we've made the park so good that it's being overrun by people who want to visit it. And your fourth point framed it for me well, that I think one of the biggest issues we're going to need to wrestle with is, like, what do we want that park to be? Should it be primarily for our citizens to enjoy? Is it really a visitor site? And in which case, do we need a visitor center? Is it really causing so much traffic and sort of discomfort for the people on Shore Road? In other words, these are really, really big issues, and I think we should celebrate it, and then we should say, okay, how do we want to poise this going forward? It's really a look 10 or 20 years forward. So it'll be a really interesting, good discussion, but it's sort of the stuff we're supposed to be doing, right? We're supposed to be looking big picture, long-term, setting policy.
Thank you. Any other comments? No? All in favor of the motion to receive the report? Any opposed? No? That passes unanimously. Thank you again for coming and for staying. Michael, are you coming back to join us? I have your name next to the next item.
It's retiring.
Although I have a feeling I have a couple of other folks out here who have come with this particular item, and thank you for waiting so long, too. Our next item is number 122 on the proposed purchase of a van for community services for senior citizens. Michael, could you give us an introduction?
Yeah, I'm actually excited about this proposal. Kathy Raftus, who's here, and Russell have hoped for a long time that there might be a van available to assist with the seniors program so that they could do more programs during the day. There's some school buses aren't available, or they're to teams, so they don't have the availability. And the seniors want to go to different things. This would be a 14-passenger van. The first priority would be for seniors. Second would be for other community services programs. And third would be for other municipal or school uses, but emphasis on municipal, since it would be available. The priority, though, is seniors. This came about, the Senior Citizens Advisory Commission that the council formed had recommended the purchase of a van. And when I met during the transition period with Russell and all the members of the community staff, we went over all the different issues that needed to be done, and one of them was the condition of the pool. And, you know, it's in the locker rooms, and the council provided some money for that. We discussed the need for odds and ends of supplies. Council took that carry forward. The one outstanding item that there still was this senior citizen van. So anyway, both Kathy and Russell have worked together to put together a proposal. went out and looked at the possible different vans, what other communities use. It would be fully accessible to those with disabilities, and you know, the audit shows that we have the financial wherewithal to do it, and I just think it's a good commitment to the seniors of the community to do this, being soon to be retired one myself. And it's also you know, a commitment to following through the Senior Citizens Advisory Commission, and I think also a testimony to the great work in the already tremendous participation of seniors in the various community service programs.
Thank you. Can I have a motion on this item? Jessica?
I move that we purchase a van for seniors at Community Services and as proposed in item 122.
Thank you. Is there a second on that motion? Kathy, thank you. Discussion? Caitlin?
I was just curious, are we looking at like a van or a bus? 14 passenger, I'm like, I brought them both up on my little handy-dandy iPad.
The price that was quoted is a 14 passenger mini bus.
Okay.
Not a van.
Right, I was just concerned, having been in a 14 passenger van,
yes.
I was wondering how seniors were going to get in and out of the van.
If you travel on the roads and you see Scarborough's got one, they've all got one, it's probably
more like this.
Yes.
Yeah. Can you show us that picture?
I don't, make it bigger.
Oh, yeah.
Like more like a mini bus.
Like
that's what I was just
like a village crossing.
Piper Shores.
Yeah.
Yes.
I think there's a picture of the one they proposed. If you go to the council packets, there's a, it wasn't a link on your agenda, but it's actually in the council packet section. There's a brochure that shows the what the bus looks like that becomes Kathy.
I
hope I didn't run the stray.
I just wanted to clarify that the difference too is that on the bus, the windows are much larger, and a lot of the trips that we take,
and could I ask a question?
Please.
And how many other of the surrounding similar programs have these buses for the program, their programs? What other towns? Does Falmouth have one? Does
Falmouth, Gorham,
South Portland,
Standish, Scarborough,
Old Orchard Beach.
has a fleet.
Yeah.
Window.
Wow.
Almost everybody but us.
Yes.
I think Jessica was first.
Yeah, I couldn't be more enthusiastic about this proposal. One of the issues that seniors have is I should say they have orthopedic issues. So they have been using our regular school buses when available. And that first step is very high. These vans will have a much lower step to the ground, allowing people with walkers and who are physically challenged to more safely and securely climb into this bus and sit comfortably too. So I don't know if you can add to that at all. You mentioned the windows. The seats will be more comfortable.
The whole package would be mm-hmm. different than in either a school bus and or one of those vans, as Caitlin was talking about. You have seen some of those vans that they've converted. If you go to park and rides at the airport, you get in those little vans, and it's really narrow.
Yeah,
and
this is not,
not really a pleasant experience. This would be a huge upgrade for the senior population. It would make a huge impact on the senior population in the community. So.
Thank you, Jamie.
I fully support this. I just have a question, as I've asked before, when we've been talking about equipment purchases and things like that. Do we ever, or is there even an option for something like this to lease versus purchase?
You know, I've always believed in purchase. The new town manager may not. You know, to me, that if you do a lease purchase, that just means you're paying X percent more to pay the bank, and you know they. We're getting on our investment earnings 0.25%, 0.25%. Any bank that we did the lease purchase on is going to charge us an interest rate much more than we can earn with the money in the bank.
Three or more.
Yeah, that's a good point. Jamie, I'm thinking you were asking not so much about a lease purchase, but a straight lease.
Right, exactly. And as opposed to owning it outright. But
yeah, You could look at it. We can look at it again. We
asked. Most of the vehicles or pieces of equipment that we, I know we asked this on a Public Works piece before, and the answer was that they're not, it's not typically something that's an option. I didn't know if this was maybe an option, and simply just for not having having to hold the asset.
Yeah.
So.
I see it as something would happen for about 10 years. We'll get it painted out with the community services logo, and and if you lease it, you don't have it as long, and yeah, maybe you even the lease is a price, so many miles and so much, and
it's bummer.
It's fair enough. I just
everyone curious. Has their own theories
just
on
curious.
It. I can't say that I'm right or wrong, that the new manager might want to lease everything. Who knows?
Just quick question. I'm completely in support of this, but you said there's going to be a huge impact on the senior population, which I would agree. Do you have actual numbers of the people in our community would use this type of facility based on participation in past programs? I'm just curious. Have you ever done those calculations? Yeah.
Excuse me?
Have you ever done those calculations on numbers of people?
Not on the whole program, how it would impact, but on many of our trips, as an example, we have to limit it to 10 people to utilize certain transportation that's available, where this would then up it to 14 plus the driver. So there would be increases of that way. Also in the areas that we have to then get ourselves to a different location, we would increase our usage of it versus traveling to Gorm to take their bus, traveling, so making our people travel in a different way to get there. So I don't have the whole numbers of the impact, but I do know that it would be huge from the impact in the what we've heard from the people.
When we are done with our council discussion, I neglected to invite you to come and speak, but I will before we take our vote. How's that? Good. Okay. Any other comments over here? No? Yes, Jessica.
Yeah, and as Mike pointed out, the proposal, this would be community services van or bus, minibus. Seniors would have top priority, but this would also be available for other community services programming, including children. And one of the big issues is that a great deal of what is currently available for transportation belongs to the school department. And so we are limited oftentimes as to how we get people where they want to go. And there are quite a few senior programs that are very popular happening all the time, and people have to be turned away.
Okay. And I will just say, I wish it were just a little bit less expensive, but I love the idea, and I'm really glad you brought it to the council. Thank you.
Right,
and
thanks.
Having said that, please, if you'd like to come and speak to the council, give us your name, your address, see if you can limit your remarks to 3 minutes or less.
My name is Chuck Rizzuco. I live at 6 Wambach Road, and thank you for allowing me the opportunity to express my opinion. Despite my youthful appearance, I have been participating in the seniors' local tours and stuff since the 2 years since I moved here, retired here. And one of the things that's really struck me is basically, one, I'm typically the only male on these trips, and usually the only youngest person to boot, but most of these people are living treasures, history. I've learned so much from these people about the town, the history, and stuff like that. And what really pains me is watching these people trying to get up onto a yellow bus. And as much as riding down memory lane in a yellow bus is fun, when you reach 60, trying to step up with no handrails is really difficult. Most of these people have ambulatory issues, and we're all just one twist of an ankle, one fall, one twist of a knee away from having a debilitating injury that prevents us from getting around. These people look forward to these trips. And whether it's trying to struggle to get on this big yellow bus or getting, you ask about a van, they have a white, which essentially is an Econoline van with windows with a bunch of bench seats stuffed into it. You know, you got to navigate to get through the seat belts, but you're walking like this because there's no headroom. And just trying to watch these people navigate this stuff, and they're so determined in wanting their independence. It just, this town really needs to thank these people for the years of support that they've given in terms of their taxes and everything else. And I think $65,000 is a small price to pay to make their life a little bit easier. And I look forward to seeing Mike on the bus. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. All in favor of the motion?
That's cute.
Any opposed? No? That passes unanimously. Thank you. We can move on now to item number 123. Mike, would you introduce this one?
Yes. Again, in keeping with, we're trying to wrap up as many of the council goals as possible. Mm-hmm. One of the goals was to look at some of the issues involving Cape Elizabeth harbors and aquaculture, some of those areas. So I've worked with Councillor Jordan on this, who was very interested in it, came up with a draft charge. And it's proposed to appropriate $15,000 to establish the committee, adopt the charge, and to appropriate $15,000 from the unassigned fund balance to fund the work of the committee. And one of the reasons we need some money is because we don't have any internal expertise in some of the areas that the committee is going to be looking at. And we also really are looking for someone to work with us that can staff the committee as well, since I haven't been readily able to identify a staff person who has the knowledge and expertise in this area.
Thank you.
Your time is up.
Okay, I'm looking for a motion to approve the proposal for the draft charge and the appropriation to fund the Harbors Committee as proposed. Caitlin?
I'd like to move that we approve the Harbors Committee charge along with the $15,000 appropriation to do as they need, as Mike said. One of the items on there is consider such other related matters as the town council may request. I would like to request to add that the committee inventory the public water access within our community, to have an inventory of what is available for public waters. Where can we go to the beach? Where can you launch a kayak? What's available? I'm not sure if there's a list somewhere. Maybe there is, but
Yeah, there has been such a list, probably needs updating, and you know, I think the work contemplated that, but if the council wishes to specifically include that as a requirement, it would be helpful.
Okay. Do I have a second for that motion? Thank you, Sarah. Discussion? Yep, Jamie.
Mike, I have a question. Can you, the point you made about not being able to have a staff person, is this something that the harbor master would not staff, or?
You know, if you look at the whole, the harbor master, we contract with yep. Scarborough. He doesn't have the full knowledge. He could be of some assistance, but if you look at all of the charge of the committee, they don't all directly relate to this type of work. You know, you really need someone that can, like last time we had a guy named John Furland, who knew the science of the underground bath or whatever they call it, you know, where you look at the seafloor and all those issues and, you know, the appropriateness of it, so, yeah.
Okay.
Yes.
So once we, if we approve this, is that somebody that you would find to staff the person with the $15,000?
I'm leaving.
this will be approved tonight, though, Mike, hopefully.
Through the chair. The hope is between now and the end of the year, the appointments committee would recommend to the council, the public members, the council during its, was there a council member on this? I think that's
two.
There's two.
Yeah, the council during its caucus would recommend the council members to serve and would get underway with identifying a consultant, issuing an RFP, and see what responses we get.
Does that answer your question?
So we're getting that. Yeah, that was my question. I'm looking at it. So we need to add, Deborah, three, that to our appointments listings.
Any other comments or questions? Jessica?
Yeah, just wanted to kind of restate
the issue with staff, and because it wasn't here, and I was just, that was one of my questions. And also, it says that the committee will elect its own chairman and secretary, and we are now transitioning to minutes being taken by staff.
Mm-hmm.
So I just wanted to make sure that was, maybe we change this.
Amended.
We amend it.
Mm-hmm.
Are you making a motion to amend that?
Yes, I move that the committee shall, that we change the sentence, the committee shall appoint its own chair and secretary, to read, the committee shall appoint its own chair, period. Minutes to be taken by staff.
How would
that's
we do
a
that?
Standing policy, you don't need to.
Yeah, you don't need to put it in, because that's,
okay. So,
yep. That's what should happen.
But then clarification on that one. The person that responds to the RFP and gets hired, are they then staff?
It depends. I'm going to ask them to staff the committee. That's,
okay.
That's the intent, is that they will do the
that's what I'm
email
asking,
notices.
Yeah.
They will do.
Okay.
I'm looking for someone to do the to
staff.
Provide the staff of this committee.
Okay.
Including technical and clerical.
Sounds fine.
So, Jessica, just so I'm clear, your amendment is to just remove the two words "and secretary"
correct
from the last sentence of committee structure. We have a second on
it.
That.
Can I just accept?
Can you add?
Well, it needs to be second.
Yeah.
Right. Can I have second. A second? Thank you, Jamie. Discussion on that? No? All in favor? Yes? Go ahead.
No, continue the vote.
Okay. All in favor of that amendment? Any opposed? No? Passes unanimously.
No, I just wanted to say, you know, depending on what we get back for proposals and the cost, you know, we might actually take the clerical and hire someone right. in the community to come in and do the minutes and the mm-hmm. that type of thing. But we haven't been able to identify an existing person on staff
no
to do that in their available time. I'm not dumping another thing on people that either have too much work to do or don't have the expertise.
Mm. Okay. Any other comments on the original motion?
No.
On the draft charge and the funding? No? All in favor? Any opposed? Passes unanimously. Thank you. Item number 123, the proposed boardwalk. Mike, you'll introduce us?
Yeah, there's a provision in the rules somewhere that we're not allowed to apply for the planning board for any improvement without council authorization. There was money included in the budget for the conservation committee to improve some boardwalks, one of which was the Cotton Brook Trail. And what it is, it's a very muddy section, about 150 feet, I believe was the, and they want to build a boardwalk, and this allows them to go to the planning board and apply for a permit.
Can I have a motion? Jamie.
So moved.
Thank you.
I'll second.
Thank you. Discussion? No? All in favor of approving this? Any opposed? Passes unanimously. Item number 124. Town manager has indicated his intent to resign on December 31st, 2016. The manager has agreed to assist with the transition while we hire a new manager. The council has met twice in executive session to draft a plan for this. I'm looking for a motion to approve that. Jessica.
I move to approve the manager transition assistance plan as presented in item number 124.
Thank you. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you. Discussion on that? No?
I just want to say one thing.
Yes.
One, thank you for considering this. And two, for anyone who's interested in the details of it, there is a link on the agenda that anyone can look online or look at the council materials in the packet for this item.
Thank you for the clarification. All in favor? Any opposed? Passes unanimously. Thank you. That is the end of the items on the agenda. Seeing that there are no citizens in the room anymore to raise any other topics that are not on the agenda, I will be looking for a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Thank you. Is there a second? Jessica.
Second.
All in favor? We are adjourned. Thank you.